It's just a great honor and a privilege to be part of this institution, much less lead it. We have a very special guest here today, Regent Bobby Stilwell. So thank you. University of Texas system has really created the greatest engine in the history of the world for cancer science and cancer care. And so it's amazing that this institution, which was born just a little over 70 years ago, had the vision. This was 3 years before we knew what DNA did, that it was actually the basis for genetics, that this institution and system had the vision that we were not just going to care for patients, but we were going to try to figure out the underpinnings of this disease and convert that knowledge into things that really end this disease. And I think we're finally on that threshold. We've come a very long way, thanks to significant investments over the decades by this nation in cancer research. And I believe that we now have a very good understanding of the molecular underpinnings of cancer. We have the periodic table for the genes that are altered in the malignancy. We have the model systems to exploit, the computational capabilities. All of these things have converged at a moment where we also have an institution that can serve as the NASA for getting this job done and inspire the rest of the country and the world to move forward into this new era of science-driven cancer care. So I just want to provide a context for some of the things you'll be hearing about today that relate to the diseases that you'll hear. And we'll also, for just a couple of the platforms, give you a more in-depth view of those platforms. But it would take a great deal of time for you to go through the entire program in great detail. So I'm going to cover things that you may not hear about in the course of the rest of the morning. The important thing to appreciate is that we can actually take on this bold and ambitious plan because we have an extraordinary institution with tremendous critical mass, singular focus, and an extraordinary base of basic, translational, and clinical research. And as you saw in the videos, an extremely important partner in this effort is the fact that we have the most amazing patients in the world that are really driven and want to help us move the standard of care forward. Last year, we saw over 100,000 patients. And this enables us to really understand the disease in context. Another important aspect, the hallmark feature of these programs, is the fact that it's not simply about finding that magical cocktail that's going to render advanced disease cured. If you want to do something about the cancer problem, you have to fire across the entire beachfront of activities that relate to the genesis and development of the disease. So when you think about the cancer care continuum, it's about understanding which patients are at risk, what are the instigators of developing cancer in the first place, and developing cancer control strategies to be able to reduce the incidence of the disease in the first place. And this is very important. In addition, one of the greatest opportunities for cure is to catch this disease very early. And so this has been a very under-resourced effort in the cancer field, yet it has the greatest near-term impact. And this is something that we want to drive forward. In addition, we need better diagnostic tests to allow us to know, for example, which prostate cancer should we subject to a radical prostatectomy or leave alone, or which early stage cancer should be treated aggressively or simply surgically excised. And this is important to understand so that we can optimize the treatment. And if treatment is necessary, enable us to really give treatments that are effective. And effective means durable responses, not simply prolongation of survival by 3 or 4 months. You know, if you need statistics to understand whether or not you've had an impact, you're not having an impact in our opinion. At the end of the day, it's about eliciting cures and reducing cancer mortality, and that's the major metric by which we will be judged. So all components are needed to drive reductions in cancer mortality. And so there are two general paths to impact with respect to the program. It's important to appreciate that we have, you know, if you want to impact on patients, we have low-hanging fruit. That is to say that we have knowledge today that if we were to simply implement that knowledge, would we be able to have clinically meaningful impact on the problem? And so this requires more of an application engineering mentality and leverages, as I'll be describing in a moment, goal-oriented, industry-like, engineering mentality leaning professional platforms that allow us to get the job done. And this is critically important because it takes a lot of technology and multidisciplinary efforts to reduce discovery to a practical endpoint. However, today's knowledge is insufficient to ultimately cure the disease. And so there are many things that we don't know, that we need to conduct exploratory science, but the type of science that we call knowledge gap science. That is to say that you understand that there's a gap that you need to close. And if you were to close that gap, you would then be at a point of low-hanging fruit that you then prosecute to actually influence the standard of care. So you have to fire on both fronts. It's taking advantage of today's knowledge and implementing it, but it's also setting the stage for the acquisition of new knowledge that ultimately allows us to render this disease in the history books. And so just this past month, we announced our request for information and ultimately applications for the collective wisdom of this institution to think about, well, what are the knowledge gaps that if we could answer them, it would drive us forward into areas of application. Now, another hallmark feature of the cancer moonshots is that it goes beyond traditional academic discovery. And so you can think about the moonshot projects such as lung cancer, early detection, for example, and what it would take to actually have a series of discoveries that you have blood markers circulating in your blood and actually convert that knowledge into a diagnostic test. That part takes engineering, professional activity to be able to prosecute that knowledge into something that can actually be used in the field. And if we think about the moonshot projects, we've thought very carefully about what are the enabling platforms that if we discover things or we have knowledge, we would be able to move those things forward. Just a few of them are listed here, and I'm going to spend the rest of my time talking about some of these programs, these platforms, first beginning with cancer control. So this is a program where it is absolutely essential in terms of impacting on the disease. We have one of the best cancer prevention programs in the world, and what those scholars have taught us, Ernie Hawk and his team, have taught us that 50% of cancers can be prevented. They never happen in the first place. However, there's a gap between discovery and program delivery that actually achieves population-level benefit. To, you know, just to tell a kid to not smoke isn't good enough. You really have to get into their heads and change behavior and have them think that it ain't cool to smoke. And so the goal is to develop and deliver evidence-based interventions. And this requires new laws. It requires a variety of other things that are at the community level. And so our approach is to provide the enabling infrastructure that brings together the diverse expertise and experience in cancer control, all the different stakeholders, folks that would influence K-12 education or educate our legislators to provide for opportunities to prevent kids from going to tanning booths and things of that nature. It really requires dedicated and sufficient resources. It is going to be very structured and milestones with clear deliverables. And that's true for all of the Cancer Moonshot projects and platforms. And it really is a focus on population-level impact. I'm very proud to report that just a few days ago, we signed an agreement with the government of Mexico, with the Secretary of Health, to develop and leverage both of our capabilities here at MD Anderson and Mexico so that we can develop strategies to prevent Hispanic children from starting smoking. It may come as a surprise, but about a quarter of high school students smoke on a daily basis in both countries or use smokeless products. So that's completely unacceptable. 27,000 kids in Texas every year become daily smokers, high school students. So we have a problem, and a lot of those become lifelong customers. So we want to actually do something about it, not simply say that smoking causes lung cancer or emphysema or other kinds of diseases. So it's critically important that we really reduce the knowledge to something that actually impacts on population behavior and many other activities as listed here. And it really takes a full spectrum to be able to reduce knowledge about the instigators of cancer into things that influence public policy. And it requires evidence. You have to understand, you can't just tell a child to not smoke. You have to have a multiplicity of activities to be able to move this forward. So I wanted to just provide a little bit of context, because what we're trying to create here is not simply to enhance the platform of what is MD Anderson, but our dream is to be able to use technology that allows us to spread the standard of care around the world. So if a CLL patient can't see Michael Keating, that person would have his brain sitting on the shoulder of that person, providing them with the real insight needed to render the absolute best standard of care. To be able to do that, a patient comes in, and this patient needs to then have various information or specimens isolated that would then go into a clinical framework and a research framework that would then be placed into a framework that will allow us to bring different types of data in and be able to analyze that data and ultimately use artificial intelligence to provide decision support as to what you should be doing with that patient based on all of that type of data. This is the future. And so a lot of the platforms that we have revolve around the acquisition of information, molecular information, or research information that ultimately will drive the standard of care and break new frontiers. Now, I'm already told that I only have 5 minutes, and I have probably another 15 or 20 minutes of slides. So this is, I'm going to go through this quickly. So this is just to help you understand that it's really about information and knowledge. So we want to have a warehouse where we can bring all kinds of information together. And we believe that we have the capacity now to analyze apples and oranges of information. And that is a big data platform, massive data analytics. And we believe that this capability will now enable us not only to drive research and development and help make better decisions, but also enhance operational efficiency. So part of the problem is also the economics of healthcare. And we want to be able to help in that regard as well. And we think that this will enable best practices and efficiencies. And we want this to be very accessible, not just to computational scientists, but it has to be understandable enough so that clinicians, researchers, biologists, for example, as well as the experts, can really use that data to break new conceptual ground in a non-obvious way. So these professional platforms have many different components. I'm just going to highlight a couple of them. For example, the clinical genomics platform. We want every patient to come in and be analyzed fully with respect to the genetic abnormalities that are resident in their particular cancer. So I'm not going to go through all of this, but essentially it enables us to acquire in a very controlled setting the biospecimens of that individual and then enlist that into the next generation sequencing platforms that allow us to look at every aspect of the cancer genome, which genes are expressed, how they're expressed, the kinds of DNA alterations that occur, and so on. And do this in a way that really drives the technology in this area forward and become the leader in the use of genome technology to influence the practice of cancer medicine. Another component is that there are many other dimensions of the cancer cell that you want to look at. It's not simply the DNA or the RNA. There are other dimensions like protein or carbohydrates on cells or the metabolism of cells. And it's like feeling the elephant. You don't want to just feel the trunk and try to figure out what the animal's about. So you want to have this multidimensional view of what's going on. And so here there are a bunch of platforms that really help us break new conceptual ground. First of all, just very high throughput genomic sequencing and data processing. We have proteomics platforms. We are, thanks to Gordon Mills, the absolute world leader in being able to look at hundreds of proteins in real time to assess how they're being perturbed by a new therapy, for example. We have the world's leader now in early detection and mass spectrometry, which allows you to look very broadly at many proteins and modifications with the recruitment of Sam Hanasch, who is the absolute leader in this area. And so there's a lot of different components that allow us in a digital way to analyze the protein space in a tumor and ultimately drive identification of new candidates for this area. Mass spectrometry is something I won't go into, but it essentially allows us to look at cells, look at the surface of cells, the internal workings of the cell, or what the cell secretes into the medium to understand the full spectrum of proteins that are generated by a tumor. We have the world's leading cancer immunology program in the world. And now with the recruitment of Jim Allison, who made this major breakthrough with harnessing the power of the immune system, and amazing other investigators like Patrick Hu and Larry Cooper and others just breaking absolute new ground, we want to enable that new discovery effort into systematic, smart clinical trials that are designed to attest and understand how various immune therapies work in patients. To do that, you have to analyze the immune cells to see if that perturbation is influencing the immune cells, or look at the profile of the immune system in that patient. We now have the technology to be able to do this. So this group is going to, at the preclinical to clinical trials level, understand how to prosecute this entirely new class of cancer drugs, which arguably is the most exciting advance in cancer therapy in the last 10 years. We also have the Institute for Personalized Cancer Therapy. John Mendelson, Gordon Mills, and others have been instrumental in enabling us to really break that new ground. This is really not cutting edge, it's bleeding edge analysis of how to understand the genome and bring that type of knowledge into smart trials. And then ultimately that becomes organized and systematic that then gets into regular clinical practice. So they are breaking new ground to be able to drive those kinds of activities forward. And I apologize again for going through this very quickly. Another very important component is our ability to do not just clinical trials in humans, but do clinical trials in mice that are recapitulating the human disease. There are 900 drugs in development in the pipeline today. We want to be able to use those model systems to understand whether or not the drug is going to work and develop clear hypotheses to know which patients to test and which combinations of drugs to use. This has been a revolution in the field of medicine, and we're going to exploit these preclinical models and use all of these different technologies to essentially do a clinical trial in a mouse hospital, very sophisticated, so that we can really test ideas before they go into people, so that we can bring the best ideas, the best drugs, the best combinations forward in a way that really makes a difference. In addition, and this is the last point that I want to make, is that in pharma tends to go after the same areas, the same drugs. There are many drugs targeting the same molecules, but as a result of the Genome Project, we now know that we've been dealing with the tip of the iceberg and that there is a treasure trove of new targets. And so one needs to be able to have the courage to go after that space. And it's high risk. And so this is an area where we feel, as an academic institution, we can take those chances and try to break new ground and develop new strategies in very much the same way that Jim Allison did with immune therapy and led us to a new era of therapy in that regard. And so we're very fortunate to have leadership that has over 200 years of pharmaceutical drug development experience. These are very well-known individuals that have made many drugs that have gone all the way through to FDA approval. The director of this institute is Giulio Draeda, who ran Merck's oncology franchise worldwide, prior to that Pharmacia, and prior to that biotechnology and academia. And so what we have is the ability now to go from a target that we think is a very good target to go after for a drug and have all of the components needed to allow us to develop these clinical candidates that can then go forward into people. And we have all of these different capabilities that have now been built in at MD Anderson or are outsourced, but they're managed to be able to actually systematically go after new targets and understand how those targets would work and then bring those targets into the mouse hospital and test them, so on and so forth, in very sophisticated ways. This is a new day that allows us to break new ground both technologically and conceptually. So I'll end here, and I just want to again thank you for all of the time and effort that you've put into this institution and for joining us here today. I just want to make a couple of specific announcements now, which is that we'll have in this room Anil Sood, the breast cancer, ovarian cancer, John Haymack and Steve Swisher will be talking about the lung cancer program. Ernie Hawk will be talking about the cancer control platform. And so that'll be here in this room, and then the staff will direct you to other breakout sessions and so on. And then we'll be returning here, we'll conclude, and then also for those of you who are interested in staying for lunch, we have Giulio Draeda, who's the director of the Institute for Applied Cancer Science, that very good-looking doctor that you saw, Garcia Monero, acute myeloid leukemia, myelodysplastic syndrome will be here. John Haymack, Michael Keating, Gordon Mills, and Tim Thompson on the prostate cancer effort. So again, thank you very much.